Thank you all so much for coming out tonight and joining us for our first ever romance program. And we're calling this program Why Happily Ever After: Rethinking Love and Romance. Tonight, we are really pleased to present the superstar panel of romance authors and the editorial director of Grand Central Publishing's Romance Line. As you know so well, all of our programs are presented through the generosity of the Friends of the Darien Library, and we certainly thank them for that. Moderating our panel this evening is the New York Times, Washington Post, and USA Today bestseller, Sarah MacLean, author of historical romances that have been translated into more than 20 languages. She's the winner of back-to-back RITA Awards for the best historical romance from the Romance Writers of America. A graduate of Smith and Harvard, Sarah is a leading advocate for the romance genre. Joining Sarah, we have Tessa Bailey, who is a graduate of the English program at Pace University. And after a flirtation with journalism, she turned to her love, romance writing. Contemporary fiction is this New York Times best-selling author's specialty. Grace Burroughs discovered romance novels when in junior high and has been reading them voraciously ever since. Grace writes Georgian, Regency, Scottish Victorian, and contemporary romances in both novella and novel lengths. Hope Ramsey is an award-winning, best-selling author and two-time Golden Heart finalist. Her series of heartwarming romances have won critical acclaim and publishing awards. Leah Hultenschmidt is currently the editorial director of Grand Central Publishing's Forever and Forever Yours romance lines. She oversees approximately 130 titles a year and edits everything from Roman Regency and Highlander historicals to gritty contemporaries featuring the Boston mob. In 2011, she was named Editor of the Year by New York's Romance Writers of America chapter. So I'm very excited to be able to present all of these authors and editor here this evening, and here's Sarah to take over.
Thank you all for coming. Happy Valentine's Day. This is when we talk about romance. So bios were given, but I'm going to ask our panelists to perform a little exercise for us all, because I always think that bios are fascinating, but that book bios are even better. So I would love it if we could just go down the line and you guys could give what I refer to as your book print. Where you tell us a little bit about your reading history, where you came from, how you found romance, why you write romance or edit romance, and then we'll go from there.
You want to start here?
Leah, yes, I want to start with the editor.
The one who was just scribbling down titles like 5 minutes ago. No, we talk about books change lives, and I think that's true for any genre, any form of literature that you write. And one of the ones that had the most formative impact on me is Anne of Green Gables, which I read when I was young, and just that sense of adventure and love for life. Some other favorites include a novel called Phantom by Susan Kay, which is a retelling of the Phantom of the Opera story from Eric's point of view. I think it's been out of print for years, but it's always been one of my favorites just because I love that beautiful adventure story. And then I got really into historical fiction for a very long time. Sun and Splendor by Sharon K. Penman was another favorite. And I was reading so many different genres, whether it was fantasy, and Hope and I were just talking about, we read a lot of the same fantasy ones when we were young too. A lot of different genres, whether it's mystery, thriller, fantasy, historical fiction, and sometimes didn't realize I was reading it for the romance because my mom wouldn't let me read romance, you know, when I was in high school. Those books have sex in them. Some of them. I couldn't show my mom that. So I didn't read a lot of that in high school. I came to it late. How I came to romance, honestly, was answering an ad in the New York Times for an editorial assistant at a publishing house that did primarily romance. And I was quick before the interview, I better read one of their books. and it was a book called The Black Knight by Connie Mason, and it was a medieval romance, and I was just fascinated through the whole thing. I could not stop reading. I read through the night because the interview was the next day, and loved every second of it, and I read a lot of romances now.
So I have three brothers, and when I was younger, I had to do what they were doing, and they were reading boy books. And in particular, my oldest brother gave to my next oldest brother, who handed down to me, worn paperback versions of Edgar Rice Burroughs' Tarzan stories and the Martian stories, the 10, you know, John Carter and Deja Thoris. And my brothers were clearly reading these books for the action and the adventure. I was reading them for the story about John Carter and Deja Thoris, which, you know, always steal my heart, okay, because he was such a Southern gentleman. He was a Southerner, and, you know, and she was a princess of Mars. I mean, this was great. I mean, the Southern princess and the princess of Mars. I had no idea, you know, I didn't realize that was what was turning me on, or that it was different than what was turning my brothers on. I just knew I loved all these things. Well, my aunt was not happy with me reading these stories. For one thing, the books all had these lurid covers, okay? You know, you think romance covers are, you know, but these were some really, I mean, Deja Thoris always was like scantily clad. So she didn't think that it was appropriate for a fourth grader to be reading these books. So, or even a sixth grader. So sometime, it was like between fifth and sixth grade, she handed me Jane Eyre, which is about as far away from Tarzan as you can get. And she told me it was a girl's book. And I started reading it, and it changed my life. I mean, I fell in love with Rochester. I have never gotten over the love affair with Rochester. No one told me that was a romance, though. That was a classic. Mm-hmm. And I binge read everything written by all the Bronte sisters, some of which are not really what I would call romances. But then I moved on, and my brothers were reading a lot of fantasy, so I had to read a lot of fantasy. But I read things like The Once and Future King by T.H. White, Arthurian stories, Mary Stuart's The Crystal Cave, Marion Zimmer Bradley. So I got stuck in the whole Arthurian legend thing, which is all about an unhappy love affair. I moved on to Leon Uris and read things like Exodus and Mila 18, which had heartbreaking love stories that made me cry at the end because they always had terribly unhappy endings. By that time I was all full grown, and I just kind of read a lot of science fiction and fantasy for a very long time. But I was reading things like Anne McCaffrey's Dragon Rider series, which were romances, okay?
With dragons.
With dragons, okay? And strong female characters, okay? But I didn't call them romances. They were fantasy. And then one day in my 40s, I mean, you know, I was a fully grown woman. I stumbled into the romance aisle and picked up a book by Laverl Spencer and read the back cover and said, "This sounds really good." It was just an historical, it was The Gamble, which is still one of my favorites of hers. And I read it, I think I stayed up all night reading it. And it made me cry, you know, so it had the same tear factor as a Leon Uris, only it had a happy ending. I'm like, oh my God, this is the best thing since sliced bread. I went back to the bookstore and bought everything Laverl Spencer ever wrote, and I've probably read her books two or three times because she's like one of my faves. So that's my story, okay? And today I read a lot of romance, different kinds of subgenre, but I still read fantasy. I still really, really love the world building in fantasies, and I have a lot of very favorite fantasy authors, and we'll probably talk about them later.
Hi, I'm Tessa Bailey. You guys may know that. I think most of my, oh my God, I'm really loud. Most of my romance introduction came from movies. So it started off with Gone with the Wind. And my parents tell me that the first time I watched it, I was inconsolable for like a full day because they didn't end up together. You know, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. And then Titanic. Later on, where I'm told I had to be hauled from the movie theater in a wheelbarrow because I was so. I mean, like, you know.
There was room on
so then,
the floor.
So then, like, after that, there was a a family reunion that was just women only. In Maine, my family, the women in my family went there for a weekend. And my grandmother, hearing these stories, was like, you know, there's books where they end up together and there's no death and destruction at the end. And the first book I read was from her shelf, and it was Hidden Fires by Sandra Brown, which is like takes place during the gold rush era in California, and there's like a villain and twins and deception and murder and mayhem, and they end up together. And so that was my romance introduction, and I went from there. I read a lot of sea captains, a lot of historical romance with sea captains. After that, I was kind of obsessed. I used to like listen to that song Brandy, she's a fun, and I just sob and sob. So,
good job.
So yeah, I mean, like it was just a natural thing to start putting some of these fantasies in my head down on paper, and that's my romance introduction.
I read and write romance because I believe in love, and I am by day a child welfare attorney, which is miserable ever after. It makes the best sense in the world that my preferred genre to read would be romance, because often those stories will start out with two people, three or six or whatever, werewolves, who are flawed and wounded and they don't fit in and they're hurting but they're coping. Does this sound familiar to anybody? Especially folks in the, I was a single mom, the books have such a fundamentally hopeful, positive, and I think appropriate message. So they were my constant companions. I would read one book a day because that's what I could afford. And some days it was, you know, peanut butter or a book. Well, book. but one night I was in my law office, and a lot of things when you're a lawyer are on deadline. And it was not going well. I had to file something the next day, and the furnace had, you know, died, and it's 11 o'clock, and, you know, I'm sort of, I hate my life. And I always had a book with me, and I pulled the romance novel out, and I let myself read one chapter. Then I had to go back to being a lawyer, and I had the thought, I wonder if I could write one of these. I was pushing 50 at the time. And the sort of parenting arc was running its course, and I started writing a book, and I have never had such fun. So I graduated from reading for sustenance and reading because the subject matter was reading reinforces my values, to writing from the same motivations. And if anyone of y'all is sitting out there thinking, maybe I could write a romance, yes, you could, and yes, you should.
I'm so glad that you talked about the sort of motivation to read, and that everybody spoke to sort of the happily ever after, the hopefulness of the romance novel, how it's something really special to find yourself in a book with a happily ever after. But romance is incredibly popular. We know this. 80 million people last year in America read at least one romance novel. It's a $1.6 billion industry. It's the largest share of the paperback fiction market. And the average romance reader, like Grace talked about when she was coming to become a writer, reads on average 10 to 12 books a month, which is a massive number of, I'm seeing nods, so I know that there are romance readers in the room. I think it's a workhorse genre, right? I think publishing thinks of us as a workhorse genre. I know that libraries sort of see us moving in and out of the stacks very seamlessly and constantly. So I want to talk about what the work of romance is, writ large, not just our work as writers. We'll get to that in a little bit. But what's the work of the genre in the world? What's the work of the genre for readers? When you write, do you think about that? And I mean, anybody can take it and hopefully we'll have a conversation about it.
Well, I'll start. I I wanted to be a writer my whole life. I didn't know what genre I wanted to write. I finally settled on romance very, very late in the game. I had written several other fantasies mostly. Mm-hmm. Okay. Although there was a Washington potboiler in there somewhere. But the books that I finally did sell, I began to write shortly after my mother's death. And for me, at the time, the loss of my mother was devastating. My father had already passed away, and I felt like I was an orphan. And I just wanted to go back to when I was a child and spent time in South Carolina with my aunts and uncles, all of whom had passed away. My mother was the last one in her generation to go. And I just wanted to travel back to that happy time when I was a child. And that's how the little small town of my first series, which is called Last Chance South Carolina, that was how it was born. It was just a way, it was part of my grieving process to bring people back to life who were gone and to spend time with them. And I'm crying, okay, sorry. But I think, for me, I finally knew I was on the right place because I had gotten to the right emotional space in order to write romances. Because I had to go there. I mean, and I think that these books do get you in touch with your deepest emotions. And I think when you're writing them, the best writing is always when you go to the place that you don't really necessarily want to go to, but you have to go to sometimes, which is sometimes very hard. But in this case, it was just really wonderful because I really did get to spend time with these people that were gone.
Do you still write for yourself, or do you think about readers more? And that's for everyone too.
Yeah. Well, I do think about readers. I want to write a good story. So, you know, to me, the story is always the most important thing, because I think that's what readers are looking for. That's what I look for in a book, is a really good story. And so I do really work very hard to write good, interesting stories with twists and that sort of thing, and quirky characters and whatever. But I do really think, and maybe this sounds very selfish, I really think that my writing is really mostly for me. And whether I was published or not, I would still be writing. I wrote for many, many decades before I made a sale. You know, it's just something that I need to do.
Well, I'm a reader. So when I write, you know, I'm writing for myself and the reader at the same time, I think. I mean, I want to find out what that AGA looks like, that Happily Ever After looks like, just as badly as I want to share it with the readers. Like, I am racing to that moment because I'm so excited about it. So I feel like it is for both of us. But I recently asked this question to my Facebook group, my private Facebook group, why do they read romance, and has that reason changed since when they started to now? And I was so shocked that it's like every single person, the reason has changed throughout like the 10 years they've been reading. They started off like for the, you know, OCX. Or the escapism, and now it's like they read it for, you know, like the little moments, like the softer moments between the hero and the heroine. They kind of just want to, like, live someone else's life for a little while in a book. And a lot of it is, you know, because romance, we see the heroine is like our looking glass into the world. So through the heroine's decisions, like, the reader learns a lot about themselves, like how they feel about the heroine's decision, how would they react, and through reading them, they learn a lot about, you know, their own inner self. So there's a lot of different reasons, though. There was probably 20 different reasons that women said they read romance, and I'd say the most popular, though, was that they can just, there's not a lot of happily ever afters in the real world, so they want to believe in it, and they can believe in it through these books, and it's a great thing.
Sarah asked, what is the work of the genre? And I think sometimes the work of the genre is to get you through your little sister's wedding. killing her or the groom or your, you know. We're laughing, but that is no small thing. If you can get through the wedding without making a big scene, without getting plots, The wedding won't be remembered for the misstep you made, because you had a Julia Quinn novel there to go to decompress with for a couple hours. And that thing cost you maybe $6 and it saved the wedding. And it's the same, you know, it can get you through Super Bowl weekend, it can get you through the Christmas week. And this is not unique to romance, this is genre fiction generally. Where I think romance does more heavy lifting is that it reinforces the values of love one another, be kind, tell the truth. The sort of eternal verities that we associate with an honorable life, but you don't really hear much about them overtly. Many people live them by example, and that's important too. But when you can read a well-constructed story that entertains you at the same time it tells you, be the good person you know you can be the courageous person, the creative person, the persistent person, all the heroic values are reinforced in a romance novel, and you can get through their family reunion. So I think it's a genre that does an awful lot of quiet good.
I think that's true. Yeah, I was just going to approach not being a writer from kind of a different, talking about the place of romance in the world, and thinking back since I've been in the industry over some of the trends that we've seen based on world events. After 9/11, for example, in 2001, we saw a very large resurgence of small town contemporaries, communities pulling together, and people helping each other out. And again, those very kind of values that Grace was talking about making a resurgence. Then in the years that followed, and we're still very much in a suspense vein right now, romantic suspense, thriller, minute, fast-paced read. Military heroes, Navy SEALs were big, continue to be big in the romance world, but especially when you look at, 2011, 2012, you put a Navy SEAL on that book and boom, you know.
Dog tags.
Exactly, it's all about the dog tags on those book covers. What woman did not want to be swept away by a muscular man who could pretty much take care of anything, as well could she. And yeah. That I think is, I'm sure we'll talk more about, but that strong woman who can hold her own against any hero put with her. We're talking more about trends. Cowboys right now, again, values, these classic values that honor the integrity that you see in these quintessential characters. And you know, it's easier to do in retrospect to look back and say, of course, that's why Robin Carr's Virgin River series became so popular when it did, as this community pulled together in the simple values times. Of course, this is why military heroes are booming right now, and or even historical heroes who are dashing and witty and not necessarily what we see in real life, courteous every day. So I think romance can often become a reflection of what's going on, larger events in the world. And there's always something for every reader in the genre, because there are so many different categories.
I want to go back to something Tessa said, because I was really interested about your Facebook group and why they read romance, and how romance has sort of taught them things about, how romance can teach us things about our life. And I don't know if you all know in the room that writers often talk about something called a core story. And what that means is we find ourselves, after writing 6, 8, 10 books, looking back on our career and saying, oh, we always write the sort of same story. We tell the same, we place the same heroine at the center, and we tell the same sort of thematic, kind of big picture, 30,000 view story, even if we're writing across genres or incredibly prolifically. So I want to ask these writers, do you feel like you do have a core story? Do you know what it is? And I'm going to ask Leah too, if you feel like you have a core story as an editor, is there something that you always feel like you're drawn to? Uh-huh. And what has your writing taught you about yourself, maybe, and about the way you look at the world?
Go.
Yeah.
Go first.
Quick question.
I write a ton of evil moms. I don't know if that's because, no, my mom's not evil. But let me see. I think, my editors comment a lot that I don't have a lot of outside conflict. It's a lot of between the hero and the heroine, most of the conflict. It's a personality conflict. It's this person's past and their trauma. It's going to conflict with the other, with the hero or the heroine's personality, the way they are. You know, like I have a, in one book I have, just to throw an example out there, I have a pyromaniac who is also claustrophobic, but then she meets the hero who is, he's dominant and he's into, tying up his partner. So she's claustrophobic, so there's definitely a problem there. There's a, that they have to overcome, and it's not just an overnight thing. It's a, why does he want to do this, and why is she like this, and they have to work through it together. But I think, I don't know if I have a specific core story, but it's definitely not, there's usually, it's mostly inner conflict rather than the outside world keeping them apart.
I wouldn't say I have a core story, but my stories tend to be in a context of large families or extended community, whether it's family of origin or family of choice. And I'm going to have to think about, I have thought, do I have a core story? I might have to ask my readers this. Because they'll spot patterns I can't see from, don't ask a fish about water. Mm-hmm. I guess I'll just keep an eye on this one. Because if you have a core story, you can write the daylights out of it. I wouldn't say I operate from that strength myself.
I think, as I've written more and more books, I've come to the conclusion that my parents took me to way too many Gilbert and Sullivan operettas as a child. I am incapable of writing a story that doesn't have a cast of millions and a plot that where everybody's meddling with everybody else. Now they tend to be small town stories, but even the last book that I turned in, which was less of a small town, I mean, large portions of it happened in Washington, D.C., there were just a lot of characters just messing around with everybody else. I mean, just messing with everybody's life. And the kind of topsy-turvy that you kind of see in a Gilbert and Sullivan. And I have no idea why I write that story. Okay, I mean, I have, obviously I saw too many operettas as a child, but that obviously... I need a cast of millions in order to tell a story.
I was just thinking, I do, in all my series, have a group of guy friends. That is a definite theme in all my books. I love that dynamic between just guys, encouraging themselves in that kind of gruff way, encouraging each other in that kind of gruff, no-nonsense way, and needling each other into, doing the right thing. And there's always, the more I think about it, there's always a strong woman that they kind of meet their match with. So,
Well, I also write a lot of fish out of water stories, mm-hmm. and redemption stories. I mean, I seem to go back and forth between these two stories. I do write a lot of fish out of water stories. And again, I have no idea why. That story appeals to me. It just does. The redemption stories, I really do understand why, because I think there's a story arc that actually has a name. It's called The Sinner's Redemption, and it actually has a number of story steps. And I've blogged about this because I'm kind of storytelling wonk. But that story just appeals to me. It's basically the story that you find in Scrooge, in Christmas stories, Scrooge, and It's a Wonderful Life, and the, you know, the Rime of the Ancient Mariner, for example, is a redemption story. It's a story about somebody going through, you know, really horrible, horrible things, and then coming out at the end. And I write a lot of Christmas stories. I'm asked to write a lot of Christmas. Someone told me, you give good Christmas. I don't know why. And I think it's because every single one of my Christmas stories is a redemption story, which is something that, you know, people want to read at Christmas time.
I kind of like Grace, I wish I had somebody else here to tell me. That somebody being a John Charles, if you guys know him at Booklist, he always tells me, he's like, oh, Leah, I always know when it's one of your books. And I'm like, how? How do you know when it's one of my books?
I review romance for the Washington Post, and I have learned who, I mean, I feel the way that John Charles does about your books. There are certain editors who I can tell.
You can tell. It's their thing. And I think some of it is, I always appreciate a good sense of humor, that balance of light and dark, even if you are writing the deepest, darkest suspense novel, to have that element of humor in there to balance it out. If you are writing the lightest, fluffiest contemporary that's just gonna keep you rollicking the whole way, to have that emotional poignancy in there to balance it out, is something that I always think is really important. But I don't necessarily think I gravitate toward a certain type in hero or heroine, and definitely I've edited all across different genres, whether it's a historical western or modern day gangster book. that is varied, because I find that most interesting. But I'll ask you next time.
Yes.
Yeah. What's your core story?
How about I answer about Leah?
No. Your core story.
My core story is awkward woman saves the day. Always. I mean, can't get away from it. Every time I sit down and try to write a book that is not that story, I end up blowing my deadline, making my publisher very unhappy, and then having to go back and fix the book. But essentially what I look for is, what my heroines are always at the center of the story, and they are always complicated in some way that sets them apart from society. So they've either made a terrible mistake, or they have, by virtue of chance or choice, set themselves.
And genuine.
Well, thank you. I like that you're genuine. But I'm drawn to people who have flaws. And in general, largely because I'm greatly flawed. I mean, I know it's hard to believe, but. And so my heroines are always, you know, deeply flawed, almost to their own and my detriment. So, flawed heroine saves the day. What about, let's talk about the work of writing then, the actual everyday work of writing, because we, as I said, everybody on this panel is very prolific. Okay, Grace, how many books have you written?
A lot.
50, and Tessa?
I think I've published 32, written 40.
In how many years?
In four.
4 years.
Yes.
Yeah. And Patty, for you, was it 7?
5, 6, something like that.
And yeah. Hope?
I've been writing 2 books a year, but I only have 13 or 14 under my belt so far.
Only.
I'm recently published compared to some others.
And part of this is feeding the beast, right? Feeding the romance reader who is compulsively reading all the time. When they read a Grace Burroughs book, they then want to read every Grace Burroughs book there is, and then they get to the end in 32 hours.
Yes.
And poor Grace has to keep writing.
Then they tell you to write faster, please.
Write faster. Yeah.
So, can we talk a little bit about process? Because I know audiences often like to hear about process. But also I'd like to talk about, what does writing do for you? Does it energize you? Does it exhaust you? Is it, we're all friends. You can tell the truth.
I'll jump in on this one. I was married to a distance runner. He's a wonderful guy. And his idea of bliss was to go for a 15-mile run on Saturdays. And he would tell me about getting in the zone, where you feel like you can run forever, and you sort of lose awareness of yourself, and time ceases to have meaning. I'm thinking, dude, you're oxygen deprived. but so there I am writing away on a book that's working. I lose awareness of time. I have no awareness of myself. And the light bulb came on, bing, I'm in the zone. That poor sucker had to run 15 miles to get where I get in the writing chair. I love to write. I love it all. I love the wrestling with plots because I'm a lousy plotter, or I'm not an organic plotter. I love interacting with the readers. I love creating the stories. I like polishing that anthracite into a diamond. I feel like it's what I was born to do, but I didn't really start doing it until I was pretty old. So compared to doing child welfare law, writing romance novels is the bomb.
I'm not at all like Grace. writing is incredibly hard work for me. I'm a pre-outliner, you know, and I have this very OCD process I have to go through in order to figure out what it is I'm going to write, and I have most of my scenes sort of figured out. Although there'll be ones added, but I'll have like the major parts of the turning points all figured out, and they usually come out kind of the way I thought they would at the beginning. So I'm not one of those writers who writes to be surprised. No, I know where I'm going. And then just producing the words is so hard. The editor in my brain clicks in, and it's just agony to write the first draft. Once the first draft is done, I can edit until the cows come home. I'm so happy to be editing, and you know, like somebody take the book away from me because I'll edit it to death. And I know that that makes me so different from like everybody else that I know. Okay, but there you have it. I just have a real hard time getting the first set of words down, and then I'm fine. But wow, writing the first draft is terrible. And I know most authors that I talk to, they tell me that they love it when they start a new book because they're all just excited when they start a new book. I hate starting. I don't know these people from Adam. I have to write a lot to figure out who they are, and then I have to cut a whole bunch of stuff. So when I get to the end and I've been like with these people for a long time, then it goes really fast because I know, and then I really enjoy it when I get to the end of the book, and then it's yay, it's done, okay? Okay, and then I can edit them and fix them and do whatever, do revisions, but oh my God, starting a new book is like torture. So I wouldn't recommend it to anybody. Unless you really feel like you have to write, which as I said earlier, it's like, you know, even though it hurts, I have to do it. It's like sick.
Yeah, I am one of those people that just, I'm the first draft, like, that's my jam, and then the editing is what kills me. It's like that, I have to give myself a week to psych myself up to even open an email from my editor. Like, that's how in my head I get about it. But I love writing, I love every second of it, but it does take a lot of discipline. Like, you have to be disciplined or it's not gonna happen. You have to have hours set aside for writing, and like in my desk at home, I have an hourglass. Like, that's what works for me. Everybody has a different thing. Turn it over, it goes for half an hour, and I go full out for half an hour, and then I can...
Sprints.
Yeah, they're called sprints, yeah. And I check social media, and then I turn that hourglass back over, and I go for another, and I have to get to, you know, 3,500 words to 4,000 words per day. Those are my word targets.
For the audience, how many pages is that?
We'll say like most of my books are between 60,000 to 80,000 words. So if I write 4,000 words a day, I'd say that's probably like five or six pages with a single spaced.
Yeah, I would say that's more than five pages.
Single spaced.
250 words a page.
Yeah.
That's 16 pages a day.
My goal is only 1,200 words a day.
I think it's like can't write. I don't know. Maybe I write in a smaller font.
It's a lot.
The point
is,
it's a lot. Yeah.
Words a day is a lot.
What was the other?
Process.
I forgot where I was.
process? Does it excite, like?
Oh, the plotting. My process has changed so drastically from when I first started. I mean, that first book, I didn't write anything down. I was just like, chapter one, and then I just pantsed the whole thing, and so I didn't plot a single page of it. And like, there's, you know, character questionnaires where you can ask your characters 21 questions, and then so you know them better once you start the book. But none of that ever works for me. The second I start writing, it's like they're completely just what they want to be. So every book for me is different. I have certain scenes I know I need to hit throughout the book. They might be like a scene in the beginning that I know is gonna set the plot like ball rolling. There's a scene towards the middle that I need to get to, so I have to figure out how to get there because it's gonna be the next plot point. So I work in a series of like scenes I know I need to get to. But that's kind of my process. Haphazard.
Do you have anything to add?
No, just that I can tell you, every writer's process is very different. And I try to learn to work with everybody in different ways. Some people, as Tessa was saying, are pantsers. They have no idea what they're gonna write, or they'll write you an outline and then the book will be completely different when it comes in because the characters spoke to them in a different way. Some authors give me, this is what's gonna happen in chapter one and this is what's gonna happen in chapter two, and are incredibly detailed and stick to every single point that they hit all the way through. Some authors love revising. They can't wait for me to call them as soon as I finish reading their manuscript and they want to dive right in and brainstorm and talk about ideas. Some I know I have to send the manuscript and wait 3 days until they're done cursing my name or crying in the closet. And then I can call once they've had a chance to like kind of think things over and brainstorm. And then we come up with some great ideas and brainstorm. But there's no one process. There's no right way. Everybody is very, very different.
So I want to be conscious of time because we're ending at 8, is that right? Okay. So I want to do a little bit of recommendations from our panel. I'd like to do a lightning round of sorts. So sort of be quick about this, in general.
Of course.
And the idea is sort of maybe we could talk about some books that have either influenced you or inspired you, and we'll just go down the line, and you can, you know, maybe give a little pitch for the book, and hopefully it is here in the Darien Public Library for you all to sample.
Well, it's not. We'll take notes.
Yeah. So there you go. Come back next week. So let's start with a book you wish, and Leah, I'd love you to either talk about what you wish you'd written or wish you'd edited, a book you like wish you'd had a chance at. So how about that, a book you wish you'd written? A romance novel, hopefully.
Well, there's a book coming out in May called Mr. Rochester?
Mr. Rochester.
The story of, it's Jane Eyre written from the hero's perspective, from his sort of coming of age to dealing with a wife who is increasingly unstable, to falling in love with an inappropriate governess, and eventually having a peaceful, honorable rest of his life. And that premise of writing the book from his perspective, you know, we talk about women's fiction and YA and mystery. There is no such thing as men's fiction. Why is that? This book could be men's fiction. I wish I'd written it.
Who is the author?
Sarah Shoemaker.
Right, and she's a librarian.
She is a librarian. It's coming out in May.
We just got the art that I can't wait to read.
I don't know if I could have. I know I couldn't have written this book, but I wish I was capable of writing The Dark Highlander by Karen Marie Moning. It's a fantasy, it's like the whole series, it's a Highlander series, but it's like time travel. So like these modern girls go to Ireland on a tour, and they like fall through these rocks and end up in like, you know, Scotland, like with the Scottish Lairds and what's that?
Medieval
Scotland. And but then we flash forward back, they come back to the present, and it's we're in New York City. So one of these Highlanders is now living in New York City, and he has these evil spirits inside of him, and he has to try to exorcise them, and it's amazing. So it's The Darien Highlander by Karen Marie Moaning, and it's amazing. It's so amazing.
So this is a little embarrassing because I know the author, but I don't remember the title of the book. But it's the first book in the Seven Waters series by Juliet Mariller. It's the series of something Seven Waters.
Yes.
The Daughter of Seven Waters, or?
It'll come to me.
I can't
remember.
You
raised your hand too fast.
I can't remember the title, and I'm racking
see
my brain.
It's pink.
Yeah. Well, anyway, if you haven't discovered Juliet Mariller. She's a Australian author, and she writes fantasy. But all of her
Daughter of the Forest.
Thank you. Okay, first book. It's part of a series, and it's the first book in the Seven Waters series, and it's a retelling of the fairy tale that many of you have heard about the woman who had seven brothers, and the witch curses the brothers and turns them into swans. And the sister has to weave nettles in order to turn the swans back into men again. And so it's a fairy tale that you may have heard before, but this is a whole book that really tells that fairy tale. And there's an unbelievably beautiful love story in this. And one of the requirements in this fairy tale is that the heroine cannot speak for it. She has a year to weave nettles, which will wreck your hands, and she's not allowed to speak a whole word. She has to be silent for an entire year. And what is so incredible about this book, it's in first person, and it's a character who does not speak for most of the book. So, and she's falling in love with this guy, but she cannot speak to him. And, oh my God, it made me cry. It was so great. And it was a good fantasy, too, because it was this great, Irish fairy tale. All of her books are, you know, based in Ireland and very deeply steeped in sort of the fae and the little people. And I love everything she's written.
My heart is, like, pounding, remembering.
Oh, it's such a great book, okay? Will make you cry. Mariller, it's Mariller, I believe. It's Juliet, yeah.
Mariller.
Yes, it's one R, two L's.
Yeah.
Juliet.
It's a French name, but she's Australian.
She's Australian, yeah. And I had a chance to meet her once, and
she's
I was like, such a fangirl.
I just. Yeah.
We love that moment.
Initially, I was going to say Outlander, but everybody knows that. It just sort of fed my whole love for history and fantasy and romance. It's kind of all there. But then I think about, oh my gosh, if you'd edited that book, that is really long.
a lot of fact checking.
Yeah. That's a lot of editing. But one that I would love to recommend is, and I wish I had a chance to work on, is Flowers Through the Storm by Laura Kinsale. It is a, I hear a whipper in the audience from another fan, a historical romance about a Quaker nurse who is in England and in an asylum where our hero has been put because he has had some sudden illness, and because of the times, they don't know exactly what it is, but he can no longer speak. And again, you go to this whole can't speak thing. How do you communicate when you can't talk? And he's frustrated by it, but he knows he's not crazy and he doesn't belong in this institution. And she is trying to help him find himself again, and talk about cry. And it is just so emotional and so touching, and just such a beautiful, beautiful love story.
I'm unsurprised by this. Didn't you edit The Madness of Lord Ian McKenzie?
I did.
And which is the hero of, that's a Jennifer Ashley book. I'm sorry, I wasn't going to recommend, but now I'm going to recommend. The Madness of Lord Ian McKenzie is a Jennifer Ashley Victorian romance. Mm-hmm. And Ian McKenzie is autistic. Mm-hmm. And the entire world just thinks he's either mad or just horrible, and nobody wants anything to do with him. And the heroine sees him, and it is a delicious, emotional, breathless love story that you should all read immediately. And thank you, Leah, for that book.
Thank you, Jennifer Ashley. Yeah, she wrote it, and it's brilliant. Brilliant. My only comment was make him weirder.
Make him weirder. See? That's good. That's good. Push your characters. Yes.
What would you?
Well, that's certainly a good one. The Madness of Laureen McKenzie. I mean, I'm a Loretta Chase fan forever and ever, and so for me, Lord of Scoundrels is the only book that I just will come back to again and again and again. And I think Loretta is a beautiful writer, and I recommend her to everyone. Anybody who's never read a romance novel, that's the novel I offer to them. Because I think it's beautiful, and there are some moments in that. I have written now, I'm writing my 11th book right now, or finishing my 11th book right now, and in every one of my books there is an homage to Lord of Scoundrels. Also, I cried the first time I met Loretta, so put that out there. Let's get to questions.
Yeah.
There are gift bags. And if you ask a question, you get a gift back, which is exciting.
Question. Not because I want the gift back, I have a question. Given the interest and demand in this genre, would it be accurate that the genre is more welcoming to new aspiring writers who can tell a good story than some of the other barriers that we hear are almost insurmountable to the new author and other genres?
That's a great question. So the question is because romance is such a far-reaching and prolific genre, is it more open to new authors and new ideas?
Well, I can tell you,
I'm asking for a friend.
Just yesterday, the day before yesterday, we had an emergency call out from our publisher. It's a quick, I need to know all the debuts that your house has published this year. Just here are all the titles, mark an X by the ones that are debuts. I think 3/4 of them were romance novels out of everything that Grand Central publishes.
Debut, she means first book, an author's first book.
Yeah, so definitely more writers.
Do you deal with agents or do you accept pitches from authors?
We typically make our acquisitions through a literary agent, but there are exceptions if you've met an editor at a conference or had a pitch session with an editor. But typically most of our acquisitions come from agents.
I want to at this point make a pitch for Romance Writers of America, which is the professional association for romance authors. Anybody can join Romance Writers of America, and there's a sort of a track, in terms of your membership, you start out as an associate and you move up to a published author. The organization is incredibly welcoming to newbies. There are local chapters. I don't know about Connecticut, but I know that two of us are members of the D.C.
Yeah, we're the RWA NYC.
Yeah, so there are local chapters. The chapters have monthly meetings where they will teach you how to write. You will find romance writers are enormously willing to help newbie writers. I mean, most of us don't view this as a competition. We kind of believe that, there's always room for new voices. And I have to say that Romance Writers of America taught me a lot about how to be a writer in many, many different ways. And then in terms of the conferences that the various chapters and national hold is where you can meet editors and make pitches.
Yes.
I understand you had a session this afternoon in the library here, and that one of the topics was de-embarrassing the romance novel to readers. And yeah. I started with your books, and the covers are lewd, the covers are kind of...
We do our best.
I'm having it turned over when I'm coming in my car going. So did you address that a little bit, sort of coming out of the closet with openly breathing romance novel?
I just want to hear her repeat the question.
Well, first of all, she said my covers were lewd, which is great. The question was, how do we destigmatize the romance novel in terms of making it okay for women to read them and making women feel unashamed of the pleasure that they get from romances? And I did this presentation this afternoon, but certainly if people on the panel want to speak to that, I would love to hear it.
Well, I have a soapbox to get on. And, I mean, my covers are relatively sweet because I do not write particularly hot romances. But I have a political view about why we feel shamed, regardless of what's on the cover. I mean, I think we should forget about what's on the cover, okay? Because my view is that these are books that are written mostly by women for women. And because they are written by women for women, it's get to the back of the bus, because the world is not run by women. And I won't get too political, any more political than that. But you know, I just feel like we need to get over what's on the cover. I mean, I just think, you know, if you enjoy these books, just read them. Don't, you know, read them proudly. Don't put the, you know, if somebody tries to shame you for reading them, you need to come back and tell them, well, this is a wonderful book about love, about people being kind to one another, about, you know, positive message, you know, and we need more of that in the world. And I think women ought to be in charge of things, and they aren't right now. And I think that's part of the stigma of romance. It's not about the sex. It's because these are books written by women for women. So that's my soapbox.
I have a follow-up question. Sorry.
Yes, no, we'll get to all of you. I see you all, and we'll just, you know, say a little
bit. We're happy to be here.
Yes.
So I know that there are lots of wonderful ladies here. Enlighten me a little bit. Do you have seen men reading the books, the romance novels, or no? Are they making progress? I know how I enlighten, you know, the male friends in my life about various issues, but I was wondering what happens in the romance section.
Do you want to give your shot?
So the question is, there are a lot of women in this room. Do men read romance? And the answer is yes. 16% of romance readers last year identified as male, which is great. I do have it depends, obviously. Certain genres get more attention. Romantic suspense gets a lot more male readership. We're in a golden age of romance right now. It's 2017, and thanks in large part to ebooks and the sort of ability to publish widely for both traditional and self-published authors, we're able to kind of serve anyone's kink, whatever it may be. And I don't just mean sexual kink, I mean kink of the heart, right? So we're seeing far more diversity, we're seeing gender diversity, we're seeing, much, much more varied backgrounds, more varied cultures. And I think men are coming to the genre because of ebooks, because they feel mm-hmm. safer. Reading them. So welcome, we take all of you.
I'll just add super quick personal anecdote there. I sent my father's a super avid reader, loves just thrillers mostly. So I sent him one of our romantic suspense books, and I was like, oh Dad, I think you might enjoy this. And a few days later I checked back in and he's like, that was even better than J.D. Robb. And my first reaction was, oh my God, Dad, you're reading J.D. Robb.
That's great.
I love it.
Okay, these two ladies both have questions, so we'll go 1-2, you can decide.
I'm interested in the creative process, and you all have a different one. And I'm a painter, an abstract painter. And I remember years ago an instructor said, you have to get yourself in the mood, you know, because I never know exactly how it's going to work out. There's no structure. Maybe I pick a color. But he said, you know, maybe you buy a new tube of paint or you get a nice new brush. So my question is to Grace, because you were talking about the zone. And that's where I try to get. But the process of getting to the zone is the tricky thing. And I wonder if you had something that you do to put yourself in that zone?
I get up in the morning, I make one cup of jasmine green tea, I deal with the menagerie, I sit my bee honkus down in the writing chair and I write. And the bluebird of creative bliss may come and sit upon my head one day a week. There may be one scene that goes really well, but it's intermittent positive reinforcement. You never know, you know, when the pellet's going to drop out into your little, between your little pigeon feet. And that works for me. And it's, I want to make sure when the bluebird's fluttering around that I'm in my assigned chair.
Yeah, I remember Robert Frost, I think he said something about, you know, going to his typewriter before computers, of course, and then writing something he didn't like, and then it was, what, the other road? Or
the road less traveled.
The road less traveled, yeah. Came next. Mm-hmm.
And we're all thinking two roads diverged in a yellow line.
Go ahead. Take it away.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. That's great.
I just want to come at you all talking about the fact of some of the books you read when you were younger. And I was thinking in my many years of reading romance novels, starting out, Barbara Carmack was one of the first. And the women were all these sort of weak kind of, you know, you had the big strong man who came in. It was almost like the fairy tale, the prince mm-hmm. and the princess, and the prince had everything and he brought the little princess along. And gradually over the years, as the genre has changed, the women have become an integral part, and you know, they're the strong ones and they're often the ones that solve problems and take care of things. And how do you see the male and female roles when you write? Does it differ? Does it?
When I sit down to start a book, I am one of those people who like does the questionnaire. And not really, but I go through a process where I figure out who my main characters are, and I figure out how they're wounded. To be honest with you, I figure out their backstory, and I figure out, you know, how they're imperfect, what their flaws are, and what they need to learn in order to find love. Okay, when they start their story, they are not capable of having profound love, and so I'm always trying to solve the question of, what does my heroine or what does my hero have to learn in order to be able to be in love with the person? And often, the you know, whatever it is the hero needs to learn, the heroine's going to teach him. Not always, but I mean, sometimes the plot will teach him that. But often the heroine's going to teach the hero something, and the hero's going to teach the heroine something. There's always a barrier between them. They're not going to realize that. But the whole story that unfolds is a series of scenes and events that help them practice learning whatever it is they have to learn. So I never think about one of them being more, you know, stronger than the other. To me, they both come flawed and broken, and through the course of the story, they're made whole. As I write, very often, you know, you have to write in romance, it's hard because you have to write two story arcs. You don't have to do that in a lot of books. So writing romance actually is a little more difficult, I think. But as I write the book, very often a book will frequently be more about the hero or more about the heroine. I don't always come to the story saying this is always going to be the woman's story. Sometimes the road that the hero has to travel is way far longer, but the heroine is there, you know, pushing it and prodding him. The book I have out here, my Christmas book, is a redemption story, and the hero has to be redeemed, and she's the redeemer. So so that's the way I come to it. It's never, you know, it's not the princess story. I mean, it might be, but it's not necessarily a princess story.
Yes.
That is a really good question.
What is the average duration from the beginning of your novel to the end of the novel and the timeline where all the redemption happens and everything kind of leaves?
So the questions were, the first question was, oh my God, I was so blown away by it that I was gone from
good, good question.
Where do we cross the line from romance into something else? And I'm going to ask you to answer that.
Yeah, I'm happy to, because I have to figure out what's crossing the line every day. But for me, the primary focus of a romance novel is the development of the relationship between the two main characters of the book, whether it's man and man, woman, woman, you know, whatever they are. But it is the development of that relationship that is front and center and carries you across. If it becomes overshadowed by the thriller or overshadowed by a mystery aspect, then it's either going to a different genre or we've got to do some edits to bring that romance, that relationship back to the fore.
And the second question was timeline. I'm going to ask Tessa to tackle that.
It depends on the book. Mine do really tend to have a pretty short timeline. I'm kind of an insta-love junkie. That's kind of my thing. Currently I'm writing a series that the four books take place over the course of one road trip. So you can imagine, it's like, it's 1 month, the road trip is 1 month, and each book has to fit into a week, pretty much. So it depends, like, you know, some take place over the course of 4 or 5 months. Some, it just depends on the book and the story and the length of the book.
Grace, you've written decades, right?
Books take place
over many years.
Yeah, so many.
I tend to break it up into different, there will be like a prequel that'll show a couple young and courting, then another story that catches them 5 years in, and then a whole bunch of stories where you see their children getting married, and you have followed them, you feel like you've known them since they were courting. But I've also written a few weeks, because I write Regencies, and the London social season was just a handful of weeks. It was sort of between Lent and when grouse hunting started. The end of Easter when grouse hunting started August 12th. And that's the latest. And people wanted to get out of London in the summer because it was hot and disease-ridden. So you really had April and May to find a spouse, and then we're off to kill some birds.
One is a little comment, because Eloisa James was on set on Sunday morning. Mm-hmm. This Sunday morning. This is the very first time ever that I see an author, a romance novel author, to say something on national television like that. I was really impressed, because they did ask her. I thought it was kind of a weird thing to ask her. So you are a Shakespeare professor during the day, and at night you are your night
lights,
you wear romance novel. And I'm like, what's wrong with that?
Yeah. Okay. Well, and if she been a man writing any other genre, would they have asked that question?
Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking about that. So for you guys who, do you find that people are still kind of, man, look at you weird because you write romance novels?
Well, my husband stopped working so that I could write romance full time, and he stayed home to watch my daughter and raise my daughter. And I became, I have been for the last 3 years, the sole breadwinner in our family. And it's been the way that the families reacted was such, it was like, well, I mean, you're going back to work, right? When are you going back to work? When are you going back to work? To my husband. And he just went back to work this last week, but not because of any pressure. It was basically 3 years of just people going like, but she can't be making it. Like, how much is she really making? Like, you know, it was kind of crazy. And we just laughed about it. You know, that's all we could do. And I'm going, my daughter is going to grow up with the greatest point of view. She's seen her mother work and her father not complain about it whatsoever. He gets up every day, takes her to school, gets her dressed. And I mean, I couldn't, you know, I've seen that firsthand, that it doesn't have to be a big deal, you know. And a couple of years back, they did a New York Post feature on mothers who write romance novels. And I thought it was going to be like a cool interest piece, and it comes out, and the title of the story or the article was "Mommy Dirtiest."
Oh dear.
And my mom still is very, she's salty about it. She's like, I can't believe it. It's kind of a weird, you can't just be this, you just can't have a successful career. It has to be a, you're taking away time from something else you should be doing, you know?
I saw a comment that it really kind of broke my heart, because I have been reading romance novels since I was in Brazil. When I first came here, that I first went to, there was a store called In and Open in the Boston area, and I went there and I saw one of the, I looked at it and I recognized an author, her name, and I'm like, oh my gosh, this book does exist in English. Of course it did. But that was one of the things that really forced me to read, because I wanted to speak the language, because I wanted to read it in its original language. You know, I bought the book, and I don't know how long it took me to really kind of really understand, but I knew the story, so it was like, you know. But one of the, and I saw somebody refer to romance novel as a women's porn. And I was like, what? This is not porn. I mean, this is like, there are some scenes that are pretty, you know, hot and everything else, but you can glaze it over. You can just, you know.
Or you can enjoy it.
Or exactly, you know, whatever. But it was really demeaning, and I felt like, how can you say this when this industry is this huge? 40% of the books published in the United States is romance novels. So how can you consider that less?
Because it's written by women.
I think maybe this last question.
I wanted to ask about your feelings about the role of romance novel in the cultural conversation about sexuality, particularly women's sexuality, and sexuality in general. So just sort of coming.
The question is the role of the romance novel in the conversation around women's sexuality.
So. I remember when the feminists, we'll put quotation marks around them, okay, ganged up on romance and basically said that our books were demeaning to women, when in fact I really do believe that our books are showing strong women who are standing up for, you know, their sexuality and for their happily ever after. The stories in these books are wide and varied, but you know, you see women in all kinds of occupations. You see them as mothers or not mothers. You know, you see them, you really see strong women who are also sexual, but in a way that is meaningful to women, because it's in the context of a committed relationship, which is, I think, what women really want. And I consider myself a feminist, and I was really ticked off. I was really ticked off when sort of the women's movement sort of ganged up and said that a whole bunch of stuff that was just ridiculous. Like, you know, women, you know, this is, we're selling some kind of Cinderella fantasy to women because life is never going to be like this, and you know, we should stop doing that and, you know, join the movement and tell women how you know, they shouldn't want that. They shouldn't want to be fully realized sexually or inside of a committed relationship. And as a woman who's been married to a wonderful man who was also Mr. Mom back when it was really not popular, for 40 years, I can say that it is possible for a woman to be a fully realized sexual being inside a committed relationship that lasts a lifetime. I mean, that is absolutely possible. I have lived that. I'd like to share it. And I, you know, the women's movement just leaves us down when they say that that's not possible. So, you know, again, on my soapbox, sorry.
No, my books do have, you know, pretty explicit scenes in them. And I get a lot of women saying that they share these things with their husband more openly because they're kind of empowered by the books. And it's, I think it's, I've heard from a lot of readers that it's good, it's been good for their relationships because they're feeling, they're seeing these heroes first, like, the heroines in the books are, they like sex. They like it. And the heroes like that they like it. It's okay. It's not something that they're like, I like it. It's just kind of understood that women enjoy sex and that the men are happy that they enjoy sex because they, you know. So the women that read these books are feel a little bit more confident in sharing these things with their husband that they would like in their own lives. So that's how it,
I'm having a little trouble wrapping my head around the question, which I believe was, how do romance novels fit into the ongoing conversation about sexuality? And all I can contribute to what has been said here is that because our reading as an activity, if you read good fiction, it tends to make you more tolerant. That is just an effect of reading. It also improves your liver function. It makes you sleep better. It reduces your blood pressure. There are many benefits to reading good fiction. So where I'm going with this is, are the romance readership reads a lot? And I think, by and large, they tend to be fairly open-minded, tolerant people. They're rooting for the happily ever after. And to the extent that more gender variety, more tolerance toward the whole gender spectrum is going to show up anywhere in literature, it has shown up in romance. There are male-male, there are menage, there are every kind of sexual identity you can think of, there is a romance for it.
Dinosaurs.
And, yes. Yes. together. Yeah. Romance makes no other contribution than that, other than giving the authors and the characters who are sexual in a different way from Scarlet and Rat. That's a valuable contribution, and I don't really see it coming from anywhere else in literature.
Oh, do we have time for one more?
I think we should probably wrap up so you can start signing, but I hope the authors would be willing
here
to answer questions like,
yeah,
right.
Yes, we
come to us.
Oh, yes, please.
And sign books and answer questions. Yeah.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you.